what we're going to sing right before communion. If you're able, I think we can stand on this song as well and worship the Lord in spirit and in truth and tune our hearts to Him as we sing, "Here I Am to Worship."
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. Beauty that made this heart.
Stated, we have been justified by faith, and we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And so as you take communion today, as we participate in this, I want you to understand the peace that only God can bring. The peace that comes because you have now been justified by faith. But you don't have to sit here worrying today over anything. If you hear this, I'm not saying we don't have concerns. We all have concerns. We heard through taking prayer requests, that we all have concerns. But none should rattle our faith, should rattle the peace that comes from God. We may have times when we kind of get out of that and we begin to worry. But when we bring ourselves back to our faith that we have, the hope that we have, there's a peace that surrounds us. Because friends, I don't care what you're facing today. I don't care what the devil may bring in your path tomorrow. I've been justified. You've been justified by faith. And so we now have peace through Jesus Christ with our Father. Don't let the world rattle you. Care what it's the news says or what people say or what your family says. Don't let it rattle your peace. So this morning, as we gather together, today we can be thankful for the body of Jesus Christ. Because, maybe this will bring you peace today, that his body was broken so that you could have peace. He lived this life in the flesh so that you could know that you, who are also in the flesh, can have peace. Because now you have a relationship with God the Father. So, Father, we thank you today for that peace that comes through the body of Jesus Christ. Thank you for that peace that comes through that. And today, in remembrance of Jesus, as his body was broken for us, he said, "Eat. This is my body, which was broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And so today we do this in remembrance of Jesus, that it's because of him we can stand here today justified. Thank you for that peace that comes in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Take the word. Scripture says that in the same manner, he took the cup and blessed it. And he said, "Drink, because this is the blood of my New Testament." Thankful today that none of you brought a goat or a bull or a ram to church. But it's because Jesus paid it all that we can now have peace. It's because of his blood that was forever, forever applied to the mercy seat so that there would be salvation once and for all. So today, we take this cup in remembrance. Father, we thank you for the blood of Jesus Christ, which washes away all sins. Father, today, may it bring us peace because we know that we've been bought by the blood of Jesus Christ. And Father, if there would be anyone here or anyone in the sound of my voice today that hasn't come to that conclusion and that understanding that it was by the blood of Jesus Christ that we are saved, if they have not received that gift and that peace that comes through it, that today, they will see your love for them. And they will allow the blood of Jesus to be applied to their life and to redeem them from all unrighteousness. So we thank you today, God. You loved us so much, you sent your Son. So we receive this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen and amen.
Forever, I
Wonderful peace. You have your Bibles this morning. If you would go with me to the Gospel of John, chapter 16. And stand if you can while we read verse 33, please. John, chapter 16, verse 33. Say amen when you're ready.
Amen.
Jesus writing, Jesus speaking, he said, "These things have I spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world." That's Father, again, we thank you and we praise you. We love you because of that peace that you bring us through Jesus Christ. Thank you today that Jesus has overcome the world. May our hearts receive that peace today. May we walk in a greater understanding of that peace. The peace that surpasses all understanding. So we thank you today. Bless your word. Bless the hearing of the word. May it spark faith into our lives. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Let me see. Title of the message this morning is Peace or Pieces. And Dirk told me I should have brought some Reese's Pieces to church this morning. I wish I would have thought of that sooner. I would have picked them up. As I've been praying, something has been happening to me that as I pray, I'm seeing visions as much as I'm having dreams. Now, I just believe I'm getting younger. Young men see visions. And the word says that he will renew your youth like an eagle. I'll claim that. But as I was praying the other day, I saw a puzzle. You ever sit down and... I'll tell the joke, okay. About, I don't want to offend any blonde, but I'm going to tell you this. The blonde woman was so happy because she finished a puzzle in 3 days, when the picture said it would take 3 years. On the box, it said 3 years or over, 3 years.
Okay.
She was so happy that she completed this puzzle in 3 days. You put together a puzzle and you get so happy because you see the completed picture. And let me tell you, there's some tough puzzles. I've done some puzzles in my day. There are some tough puzzles. You ever try to do a puzzle, a nighttime picture, all black? Boy, that's really tough. But there's a joy that comes when you see the complete picture. You know, I look at this scripture and so many others, and I may not know what tomorrow holds. I don't know the end result, but God sees the complete picture. Does he not? And so that brings peace to my life because I know that God knows the end result, even if I don't see it. But as I was praying, and I saw this puzzle, and it was all completed, and it looked wonderful. And then out of nowhere, it just busts into 1,000 pieces. Pieces went everywhere. Sometimes that's what our life seems like. Especially when we're young, and sometimes we think we've all got it figured out. You know more than your parents do, or you know more than so-and-so, and you think, I've got it figured out, I'm going to do this in my life, and ends up, it doesn't always work out that way. In fact, most of the time, it doesn't work out that way. The Lord spoke to me something that was so clear. that even though the puzzle was in 1,000 pieces, he still knew what the picture looked like. Did you hear that this morning, friends? That no matter what the pieces may look like, and maybe you've only got the corners and the edges, and you only know by faith, you only know by faith what the picture is going to look like because you saw the bells. But God, no matter what your puzzle looks like, God knows the end. God knows what the final picture is. And so I began to look at this scripture in John chapter 16, verse 33, and he said, "These things have I spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace." And then it goes on to say, now this doesn't seem like a peaceful statement, but he said, at least in the beginning of it, "In the world will have tribulation." Now, I think I shared with you a couple weeks back that I don't ask God for patience because tribulation brings patience. I don't know about you, but I don't need any more tribulation in my life. Neither do you. But patience brings tribulation. But he said, "In the world you will have tribulation. But be of good cheer. I have overcome the world." You see, being a Christian doesn't mean we don't have problems. Being a Christian means you have the answer. And sometimes when you don't even know what the question is, Jesus is the answer. Now, that may seem tough at the moment. That may seem difficult to say or to speak in faith at the moment of the tribulation. But when Jesus, now if you've got a red letter Bible, you know that these are in red. These words are in red. Jesus spoke. He said, "Be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Care what tomorrow brings. I have a peace in knowing that my God is in control." How many of you thankful that God doesn't get sick? Hello? God doesn't take a sick day. God does not run out of funds or resources. God does not run out of ability. But he has all of those things in plenty supply. It's why his mercies are new every morning. Great is his faithfulness. But Jesus wrote these, he said, "These things I have spoken unto you." Now, we're going to go through this chapter maybe quickly, maybe not. What did Jesus say to them? Okay, he said, "These things I have spoken unto you, that you might have peace." Let's go back to the very beginning of John 16. He starts off by saying, "These things I have spoken to you, so you don't be offended." He said, this could offend some of you. He said, "They shall put you out of the synagogue. Yea, the time cometh that whosoever killeth you will think that he does God service." Jesus told them that there's coming a time, and the disciples faced it. We face it and will face it. Listen to this. "Those who don't know my Father will hate you." There are church people that think you are strange. There are church people who go to church every Sunday, who think, "How can you believe God to do that? How can you have faith that God will save, heal, deliver, provide?" They think you're nuts. There are people who are sitting in church today that think the purpose of church is so I can go do my duty and go home. And they think you're strange. Bible calls us a peculiar people. Some of us are stranger than others. As an old DC Talk song said, people think I'm strange. Does that make me a stranger? My best friend was born in a manger. I've seen people who think that I'm just an odd duck. And you know what? I like it when people say, you're weird. Because I know it. I know I'm not typical. Good thing is, neither are you. We don't just come to church because it's the right thing to do or it gives us an ease or even a temporary peace of mind. We come because we know we get to meet saints and we can gather under the banner of Christ. But he said, you are going to have people that think you are strange to the point where they don't want you to come back to church. You ever had someone tell you not to come to church anymore? I have. In fact, there was one time, and I thank God he's brought me peace through it, but there was a time they didn't want me in church and they didn't want anybody in their church associating with me. Because I was a rebel. Hello. There are some people who will not like you. Just get that down in your knower. There's some people who won't like you. The reason why Jesus says, because they don't know my Father. Because all the, and I'm not calling them religious, because let me just tell you, friends, I believe religion is a good thing. Oh, I don't have religion, I have a relationship. Well, you better have religion too, because religion, pure and undefiled religion, is the one who takes care of the widows and the poor and the naked. Hello, what the Bible says, the widows. Well, that's what Scripture says pure and undefiled religion is. So religion is a good thing. But there are some people who have a form of godliness but deny its power. So anytime someone comes into a relationship with Jesus Christ, they don't understand it. They don't like it. Because it challenges their status quo. Let a person get radically saved in our church. I'm talking radically saved. And watch how many saints put their nose up. That's not how we've done it. It's been said. That's not how we do it. Let me tell you, friends, that'll kill church when you say, we've never done it that way before. Now, I'm not talking crazy stuff. I'm talking about stuff that's founded in the Word of God. But let someone who is on fire for Jesus get up in your face and you'll see how much relationship you have. You find someone who is just all out for Jesus and they don't care who he is if they tell about Jesus too. They don't care if it's in the middle of Walmart that they stop and pray for somebody or whatever. How it makes some people uncomfortable. Why? Because maybe they don't know who the Father is. As a matter of fact, they will even think they are doing God a service by getting rid of people. Same thing happened to Saul, turned Paul. Saul thought he was doing God a service by stoning Christians. He thought this is what God would do. Remember the old, what would Jesus do? That's what he thought Jesus would do. Let me just tell you something. What you think God would do is not always what he would actually do. So the first thing Jesus said to these people he was talking to is, be ready for people not to like you because You know my Father. You have a relationship with him through me. Second thing that he tells us is the Holy Spirit will come. He says in verse 7, I tell you the truth, it is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him to you. You see, Jesus said you can have peace because the Comforter has come. He said, the one that I'm going to send in my name, he will testify of me. He will bring truth into your life. We learned this morning in Sunday school. He will help you pray. Amen. It's okay that people don't like me. It's okay that the Comforter has come. Jesus said it's going to happen, so that brings me peace because he told me it was going to happen before it ever did. He said the Comforter is going to come. And he says, if I don't go away, in other words, if Jesus would have stayed here forever, the Comforter couldn't have come. He said, if I depart, I will send him to you. Verse 8 says, and when he is come, he will reprove the world of sin and righteousness and of judgment. Of sin because they believe not on me. Of righteousness because I go to my Father and you see me no more. And of judgment because of the prince of this world is, everybody say is. Is judged. Come on, friends. We give the devil too much credit, but I'm here to tell you that the prince of this world has already been judged. The one who tries to throw the wrench in your faith, the one who tries to distract you from the truth, the one who tries to get your eyes off of the author and finisher of your faith, he has already been judged. Let me tell you how powerful that is. That Satan, Beelzebub, Lucifer cannot be redeemed. His destiny, without a doubt, is hell. Oh, come on now. Now, I believe that there are people that have been on this earth that have done atrocities. I believe Hitler was a man of atrocities. But can I tell you something? He was still redeemable. Think about that. There are people who have done, now I'm not saying he was redeemed, I'm saying he was redeemable. Because there's no person here on earth that the Holy Spirit can get to, and if they will say yes and cry out to Jesus, they can be saved. See, I don't care, the worst person on earth is redeemable, but Satan has already been judged. There is no getting out of it, I promise you. According to Scripture, that there will come a day when Satan and his minions will be thrown into hell. Well, glory. Well, glory, friends. That devil that thinks that sometimes we let have so much power over our lives, he has already been defeated according to the word of the Lord, which cannot change. Not only is he defeated, he's been judged. I hope you're getting this because before it even happens, God knows the future. See, this brings peace, friends, because God knows tomorrow. He knows the big picture. He knows what's going to happen. And he stated, I call it tenses in school. I call this the prophetic purpose. Which means he spoke something as if it had already existed, but it's to come in a future time. Think of this. Because God dwells in today, yesterday, and tomorrow, all three. God is not bound by space or time. He has already been judged. Thank you for peace, God. The devil's days are numbered. He says in verse 13, howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, He will guide you to truth, for he shall not speak of himself, but whatever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. Now, what's he hearing? He says, whatsoever he shall hear, that he shall speak. See, Jesus made the same statement, and he says, I don't speak unless I hear my Father speak. I speak what he speaks. Can I tell you, the whole Trinity's on the same page? No one's speaking of themselves or out of turn or of their own wish. But they are all speaking the same thing. The Comforter speaks of Jesus. Jesus says, peace. There's a lot of scriptures about Jesus speaking peace, but I'm going to stick on here for a minute. Verse 16, look at this. A little while and you shall not see me. In a little while, right here. And again, a little while and you shall see me, because I go to the Father. Can I tell you something that's going to bring the peace into your life? Jesus said, I'm going to die, but I'm coming back. Oh, glory. This world can't hold me down. They may put me in the ground, but I promise you, in 3 days, I'm going to come back. That's what Jesus said. They're going to kill me. He said, a little while and I won't be here, and then a little while and I will be here. In other words, I'm going to be killed, I'm going to be buried, I'm going to be resurrected, and I'm coming back again someday.
Amen.
Oh. Friends, that should bring peace. Because there's nothing that the devil can do to stop God's plan. The devil thought he won, and then the devil got a rude awakening. Jesus came alive again. And then when he went up, he says, don't worry, I'm coming back the same way. Oh, friends. When I look at Revelation and I see him riding in back to the earth, oh, friends, I know that Jesus is coming back, and I know it soon. I know that it may seem like you've been talking about it for years, but I'm telling you, it's soon. I was discussing this with some others the other night, and I heard it from somewhere else, and I believe it to be true. There's nothing that needs to take place for Jesus to return for his church. Hello! Oh! Wouldn't it be something if he came right while we were in church? But wouldn't it be something even more amazing if while you're at the grocery store, while you're with family and friends over the holidays, that Jesus says, it's time. Oh, come on. Come on. Can you imagine, and God forbid, but I know it's reality, but there are some in our family who don't know Jesus. Think about if you were gathered and the rapture would take place. What kind of a testimony that would be to them? Because there's no explaining it away. There's no explaining how someone is there, but then is not. Or several people were. Most of the people that are there, and then they're not. Boy, I don't know about you, and I plan to go in the first week. Okay, that's my plan, because I have faith in what Jesus has told me, and I have faith in his word, and I have faith in the salvation that he provides me. But oh my goodness, if I was sitting there and everybody else vanished, and here I am sitting there, sitting around the table with turkey on my plate and all the fixings, and you look around and no one else is there. Boy, wouldn't that drive me to my knees. I at least the hope of one. So Jesus made this promise to bring you peace. He said, I'm going to die, I'm going to be resurrected, but you're going to see me again. I'm coming back. Oh, peace, peace, wonderful peace. And And the third promise of peace that he brings us from John 16 is, I will, these are all wills, I will, people will hate you. The Holy Spirit will come. I will die, but I will come back. And the last thing is, I will answer your prayers. Verse 23 says, and in that day, you shall ask me nothing. Verily, verily, I say unto you, whatsoever ye ask the Father in my name, he will give it to you. Now, I don't need a Bible scholar to explain that verse to me. I don't even need to go into the Greek in this case to find out what it really means. I don't care what translation you read, it's going to say the same thing or something to that effect. I will answer your prayers. Church, sometimes we think, is God listening? I want to tell you, have peace in your heart. Yes, he will. Yes, he will answer your prayers. It may not be what you want, in the method that you want. And it may not even be when, but I promise you something. He will answer your prayers. Jesus said, I want you to have peace because these things are going to happen, good and bad. I'm in control. I'm telling you these things before they even happen so that you'll have peace. Let's just say someone walked up to you today and said, when you're on your way home today and you come by a certain place in your route, car's going to come out and strike you and kill you. How could you would take a different course? I would. If someone told me if I drive Route 68 that I was going to be in an accident, I'd take 40. It's common sense to me. So Jesus is telling you these things are going to happen before they happen so you know how to prepare for it, so that you have peace in your heart. I know a lady, she's since gone on to be with the Lord. She had three nephews at three different times. All three of them were in catastrophic accidents. I mean, things that should have debilitated them or ended their life. Now listen to this. This was at three different times, but the night before these things happened, God showed her a dream and woke her up praying of what was to happen. And so she started to pray. Now, let me just tell you this. Those things actually did happen. All three times. But all three of those boys, now adults with children, they had a temporary issue. But they all came out with flying colors. In fact, the one boy had fallen off of a roof, had to have rods put in his legs, and the doctor said, we can take them out now. Hello! Showed this lady. Her name was Shirley. God love her. We're having Bible study one night, and a certain lady in our church who was past 80 years old, but was very faithful. She didn't show up to church that night. So we began to pray. That morning, they found out she wasn't even at home. God loves her. So they started this. Now this was in the middle of nowhere, outside of Paul, okay? Let me just tell you. It's like Garrett County, it's just nothing but woods. And no one would walk in the dark in these woods. So they started, the state police started a search team, different teams, to go look out for this lady. This woman, Shirley, God shows her a vision of exactly where she was. Contacted the team, they made it to where she was, and sure enough, there she was, healthy, just a little dehydrated. Come on, friend. I'm telling you, there's a peace that can come upon you that no matter what the tribulation is, no matter if they don't like you in church,
doesn't like me. Oh, come on. Well, I was sitting next to so-and-so this morning and they didn't even shake my hand. Come on, friends. Whether they like you in church or not, let me just tell you something. Don't let it take your peace. Don't let it make you think that I'll just stay home. I can talk to God on my own. But some people really get their peace is so interrupted that they just, I don't need to be in church anymore. They think that being at home by themselves will bring them peace, when actually it is disrupting their peace. As I'm telling you, friends, I don't care how I feel, whatever I've walked in here with, when I begin to converse and I begin to fellowship with the saints, there's something that happens. Because it's not no longer about what I dealt with yesterday or even this morning or this past week. What I now focus on is the Jesus in my friends. See, when you start focusing on what's important, that Jesus is in your midst. I'm not saying your problems are going to disappear, but your peace remains secure. So friends, whether your picture puzzle has broken into 1,000 pieces or not, God knows the big picture. And you can walk in faith. You can walk in peace, knowing that He's overcome the world. Be of good cheer, He says. I have overcome. Not that the problems won't exist, but that He's taking care of it. May not look like it in the flesh, but hello, we walk by faith and not by sight. So I ask you this morning, do you have peace, or is it in pieces? Where is your peace? Let's pray. Bow your heads, please. Father, again this morning, we just thank You. We love You. Thank You that we have peace through our Lord Jesus Christ. We have peace because He has overcome the world. Father, give us a revelation of the peace that You so wonderfully bring to us. And even when things happen, and they will, You have given us peace. Church may not like us, but You've promised that we can pray to You through the authority and name of Jesus Christ, and You will answer that. So, Father, we just thank You today. Speak peace into our lives, a peace that goes beyond what we know into what You know, what the Spirit says, which is truth. So we thank You this morning. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Found in the highways and byways of life, many are weary and sad. Carry the sunshine where darkness is bright, making the sorrowing glad.
May be a blessing.
Let him know.